Thank you so much, choir and orchestra. I invite you to open your Bibles this morning back to the book of Nehemiah. Find Nehemiah chapter number 4, as we have been in a study through this book for some time now. But Nehemiah chapter number 4. And today I want to speak and preach on an acronym. The acronym that I want to preach on today is the acronym YAC. YAC. You say, well, Pastor, what is that? Well, I can tell you that in the world of football, that acronym YAC is very familiar and very popular. As a matter of fact, I think that if I have done my research correctly, that John Madden, who was a famous professional football coach and also a television analyst, and also a guy whose name is on a lot of video games that our boys like to play, Madden 2019 and on I could go, but he's the one that actually coined this phrase. And that phrase for that acronym of YAC literally means yards after contact. And he would take that that acronym and he would use that to measure the success of what he referred to as his power running backs. It was the amount of yards they gained after initial contact with a player on the opposing team. As a matter of fact, the great running backs, the power running backs, are known by that more than anything else. It's the yards that they gain after initial contact. You know, when one of those power running backs initially comes in contact with an opposing player, they don't get angry and throw the ball down on the field, or they don't quit, or they don't turn around and run in the opposite direction. In fact, they do just the opposite. When they initially meet that contact, they just put those powerful legs into motion and they keep on driving. As a matter of fact, most of their yards are gained after that initial contact, and most of their touchdowns are scored after that initial contact. Now, the reason that they are so committed to this is because they know that their winning or losing is going to be determined by the yards that they gain after contact. And I really do believe that as we continue our study in the book of Nehemiah, which has really turned into our post-Michael sermons in which we are talking about rebuilding, I really think that this acronym has a lot of application for us today. Because I think the one reason that so many of God's people do not successfully rebuild is because they quit after their initial contact with opposition. And if we don't learn how to deal with the opposition that we all will face when we set out to rebuild, whether it's our church, our individual personal lives, whether it's a prayer life, whether it's a marriage, whatever it might be, if we are not committed to gaining yards after contact, then we're not going to be successful. And I think that just as this acronym YAC is important in the life of football, it's important in our Christian lives as well. So I want you to look at Nehemiah chapter 4, and we'll look at verses 1 through 9 this morning. And I think that you'll agree with me at the end of the sermon how important it is for us to gain those yards after we contact opposition. But Nehemiah chapter 4, verse 1 says, "But it so happened that when Sanballat heard that we were rebuilding the wall, that he was furious and very indignant, and he mocked the Jews. And he spoke before his brethren and the army of Samaria, and he said, 'What are these feeble Jews doing? Will they fortify themselves? Will they offer sacrifices? Will they complete this in a day? Will they revive the stones from the heaps of rubbish, stones that have been burned?' Now Tobiah the Ammonite was beside him, and he said, 'Whatever they build, if even a fox goes up it, it will break down their stone wall.' And then Nehemiah says, 'Hear, O our God, for we are despised. Turn their reproach on their own heads and give them as plunder to a land of captivity. Do not cover their iniquity and do not let their sin be blotted out from before you, for they have provoked you to anger before the builders. So we built the wall, and the entire wall was joined together up to half of its height, for the people had a mind to work. Now it happened when Sanballat, Tobiah, the Arabs, the Ammonites, the Ashdodites heard that the walls of Jerusalem were being restored and the gaps were beginning to be closed, then they became very angry. And all of them conspired together to come and attack Jerusalem and create confusion. Nevertheless, we made our prayer to our God, and because of them, we set a watch against them day and night. Now, Nehemiah and his team of builders, they were actively involved in rebuilding this wall after it had been destroyed years earlier by the Babylonians who had came in and they had sacked the city and carried away many of the people into captivity. Here they are busy building this wall. They are smack dab in the center of the will of God for their lives, and then suddenly they are contacted with opposition. Now the question is, what would they do? The real question is, how many yards would they gain after that initial contact? Now that's an important question, because their yards after contact would determine whether or not they were successful in rebuilding that wall. See, that was God's plan. That was God's will for their life. So would they allow this opposition to stop them, or would they rise up, recommit themselves, stay with the task, and get with the work? You see, dear friends, seeking to do things God's way and opposition always go hand in hand. Doing things God's way, committed to the will of God, working for the Lord, rebuilding those spiritual walls of our lives, those things and opposition go together about like steak and potatoes, or cornbread and black-eyed peas, or hot pepper sauce and collard greens. I mean, you just can't have one without the other. And so if you and I are just smack dab in the center of the will of God for our lives, doing the work of God, we can expect that we're going to encounter opposition. You know, there are so many blessings and privileges for us being able to call ourselves sons and daughters of the living God. Would you not agree with that? So many blessings, so many privileges. I mean, because we are children of God, we know that we are possessors of eternal life. Because we are the children of God, we know that we have access to the Father through prayer. Because we are the children of God, we know that we have the gift of the Holy Spirit. Because we know that we are children of God, we have a Bible that will give us direction and guidance in life. Because we are the children of God, we know that Jesus Himself has gone to prepare a place for us. And yet there is another truth that is just as vital and important as that truth. And that is the truth that there will be opposition within the Christian life. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, that famous guy who made famous the saying that when God calls a man, He bids him to come and die. He knew a lot about opposition, standing resolutely. Back in 1933, he gave a message, live message, over the Berlin airwaves, in which he castigated the German clergy and the German people for cowering down to a godless political idol by the name of Adolf Hitler. And he took heat for that. Opposition rose up because of that. In fact, because he stood for his faith and biblical principles, and he gave that message anyway, they immediately cut him off the air, cut him short. And that was really just the foreshadowing of things that were to come for Dietrich Bonhoeffer for standing up for his faith. That led to his imprisonment and ultimately to his death. But dear friends, it was Bonhoeffer's yards after contact that enabled him, his life, his testimony to touch an entire world. He didn't go down. He didn't give in. He didn't give up. He did not quit. He kept churning away, and he stood for God and the Christian faith and biblical principles. And because of that, it cost him his life. But because he didn't give in to opposition, his life has shaped the lives of many who have followed his story. So let's talk a little bit then about that opposition that we all can expect. The first thing I want to talk about is the paradox of opposition. The paradox of opposition. You know, this Bible is filled with great paradoxical teachings. And the Lord Jesus and Christ himself, he was the master of paradoxical teaching. It was Jesus who said, if you're going to live, you got to die. It was Jesus who said, if you're going to be first, you got to be last. It was the Lord Jesus who said that if you want to be a leader, you've got to be a servant of all. He was the great teacher of paradoxes. And yet we find another great paradox in this text, and that is the proof that God is at work is opposition. If there is no opposition, then probably God is not at work in that situation. See, different opposition is the sign of succeeding. Listen, what was it that brought the opposition to Nehemiah and to his workers? It was the success of Nehemiah and his workers. The Bible indicates that the wall was about halfway built. And when the wall was about halfway built, Sanballat, Tobiah, and others, they rose up in opposition, and it was because of the success of Nehemiah. You see, dear friends, listen, opposition is not proof that we are failing. Opposition is proof that we are succeeding. It's not proof that we're losing, it's proof that we are winning. And if there's never any opposition, then evidently we're not doing much to be successful in building the kingdom of God. Now I ask the question, why is it that they would be so perturbed because of the work that was going on? It was because it was God's work. And as we'll learn in just a moment, they stood in opposition to the work of God. But now listen, if you don't get anything else from this sermon, you get this today as you leave this building, that if you are faithfully serving the Lord and you are facing opposition, that opposition does not prove that you're losing, but it proves that you're winning. It's kind of like the old Rocky movies. Remember those? I still like to sit down sometimes and watch the Rocky marathons. But Rocky Balboa is there in the ring. He lets his hands down to his side. Clubber Lang and some of those others are just beating his brains out. And he's standing there, and his brother-in-law says to his trainer, Mick, he says, "What's he doing?" And the brother-in-law looks at Mick and says, "He's winning." Now, it looked like he was losing, didn't it? But in reality, he was winning. And when you and I are standing against the forces of hell, they are coming against us. Opposition is on every turn. Man, it looks like we are losing. But in reality, we are winning. And dear friend, you learned this lesson. We never build a spiritual wall that is not opposed by the enemy. And anytime we seek to rebuild those walls of our lives, we're going to face opposition. The great Apostle Paul, in speaking about opposition, said over in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 7, "But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. We're hard-pressed on every side, but we're not crushed. We're perplexed, but we're not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. We are always carrying about the dying of the Lord Jesus in our bodies." See, that's what it's like to be a faithful servant of God. You're going to face opposition. So that's the paradox of opposition. But secondly, the purpose of opposition. What is the purpose of it? Well, that's clear. The purpose of opposition is to stop the work of God. Now, why was Sanballat, Tobiah, why were they so enraged when they were building this wall? It was because if they were successful in accomplishing the rebuilding of the wall around the city of Jerusalem, then their agenda would be thwarted. I think it all goes back to Nehemiah chapter 2 and verse number 10, where the Bible says that Nehemiah had come back to Jerusalem to seek the welfare of the children of Israel. See, that was the whole problem. Because Sanballat and Tobiah knew this. If they rebuilt that wall, then the Jews would have a safe place where they could study the law of God, where they could learn the law of God, where they could practice the law of God. It would be a place from which the kingdom of God could be advanced. And that was totally opposite from what Sanballat and Tobiah's agenda was. I think that we learn a very important lesson here, and that is this world in which we live, listen carefully, the world in which we live, there are two competing agendas. There's God's agenda, and there is Satan's agenda. God's agenda flows through the church. Satan's agenda, it flows through the philosophies and the ideologies and the lifestyles of the world. And dear friend, I want you to get this clear. These two agendas are always in competition one with another. These two agendas, they cannot be reconciled. These two agendas, they cannot be brought together. These two agendas cannot live side by side. These two agendas are always at competition one with another. That's why there is the opposition to the work of God. You see, what is God's agenda? God's agenda is what is good for others. God's agenda is to promote selflessness. God's agenda is to promote goodness and righteousness and above all, truth that is contained in the Word of God. What is Satan's agenda? Satan's agenda is the exact opposite of what God's agenda is. And therefore, there will always be, listen, opposition from the secular of the spiritual. There will always be that agenda. You know, why is it, let's say, for example, why is it that a certain group of people would sue a township over a manger scene that is in the town square to try to have that removed? Why would such a thing occur? Is that manger scene a threat? No, but the display of religion and especially Christianity is a threat to the secularist agenda. And therefore, opposition will rise up when something like that occurs. Friends, listen, if our agenda never threatens the secularist agenda, we're not doing our job. If what we do and what we proclaim and what we believe, if it never is offensive to the secularist agenda, then friends, we need to check up on what it is that we are proclaiming and what we are believing, because you've got these two agendas. They cannot come together. They cannot live with one another. And a great problem in the church today is the church is rising up trying to please a world that it cannot please. Listen, God has not called us as a church to blend in with the world, to get along with the world, to make sure that we're always at peace with the world. God has called us to take over the world through the proclamation of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And if we are seeking to do that as the people of God, the church of God, friend, there is going to be opposition that we're going to face. And so if we are going to not only just survive, but if we are going to thrive in this world and reach it with the gospel, what we've got to be known for is just exactly what believers in the Bible and believers throughout church history were known for, and that was their yards after contact. What happened when they faced opposition? Did they just quit, turn around, retreat, run the other way, or did they keep on keeping on? So we see the purpose of opposition, which is to stop the work of God. But then we move thirdly, and we see the presence of opposition, and we see the presence of opposition in our text in two different ways. Number one, there was ridicule down in verses 1 and 2. You know, the easiest way to attack something you don't like is just to ridicule it. Have you ever noticed that? That's the easiest way. If I don't like something, I'll just ridicule it. I'll just make fun of it. Look at the ridicule down in verses 2 and 3. The Bible says, and he spoke before the brethren and the army of Samaria, and he said, what are these feeble Jews doing? Feeble Jews. They resorted to just calling them names. Now, in a sense, the Jews would have agreed they were feeble. They were weak. They were the minority. They were less in number than the others were there in Jerusalem at that time. So yes, to a degree, you might say that they were feeble. But what is interesting is that these enemies attacked the work of God, they attacked the workers of God, and they did it through ridicule, by calling them names. Friend, I want to equip you and tell you that if you stand today for God, there's a certain group out there, they're going to call you names. If you stand for God's plan for marriage as being an institution between a man and a woman, you're going to be called intolerant. If you stand today for pro-life and you believe that every life is sacred and the life of every baby and child is sacred, if you stand for that, you're going to be called someone that, well, you're just against women. If you stand for God, the Bible, biblical principles, you're going to be called names. And friends, I want to tell you, if you can't stand the heat of name calling, you better not get in the kitchen of committed Christianity. Because when you do, the opposition's going to rise up and they're going to call you names. How absurd for you to believe in something like this. So he called them feeble Jews. And then notice this second one. He says, will they fortify themselves? That is, literally, will they themselves, this weak bunch, do they think that they're going to rebuild this wall themselves? I mean, this wall is from 1.5 to 2.5 miles in circumference, and look at their small number. I mean, the ones that originally built this wall, they were far superior and far stronger than they. Do they think that they're going to be able to rebuild this wall? When they said, will they offer sacrifices? And offering sacrifices was just a picture of a religious activity. And I think what they're doing here, they're taunting their faith. You think you're just going to pray this wall up and it's just going to grow because you're praying about it? You think that's going to happen? I don't know of anything more unsettling than when our faith is attacked. Would you not agree? Do you really believe that Jesus Christ is the only way to heaven? Man, we live in a pluralistic society. You cannot possibly be that narrow-minded. Do you really believe that God saves people by grace and not by their works? Do you really believe that the Bible is the inspired, inerrant, infallible word of the living God? Do you really believe that, you see? There's going to be ridicule in so many different areas. And then old Tobiah, down in verse number 3, said, look, if even a fox goes up that wall, they'll break down their wall. Did you notice that word there? If a fox goes up this wall, they are a building, that fox will break down their wall. Friend, they had a terrible misunderstanding about this wall. That wall wasn't their wall. It wasn't Nehemiah's wall. That was God's wall. They were simply God's workers that were building that wall. Even a fox will be able to knock that wall down. Here's what the world says about us today. We say that we can change the world, don't we? Do we believe that? We say that we can change the world through prayer and the word and worship and evangelism and the proclamation of the gospel. That's what we say, and the world laughs at us. Listen, you can't change the world, by just using those resources, but oh yes, we can, because Jesus said, if you use the resources I gave you, which are the ones I just mentioned, I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. But you see, friends, ridicule will come to you and ridicule will come to me when we do it that way. So there was ridicule. That was the presence of opposition. There was also intimidation, which I'm not going to spend any time on because I'll come back to that one in another sermon. But what I really want to focus in on in the latter part of the message is the plan for opposition. Now, what did Nehemiah do? Nehemiah and his friends, they faced this opposition. How did they handle it? You and I are going to face opposition. How do we handle it? And the first thing I want to show you is what he didn't do. What he did not do is he did not retaliate. Did you notice that he didn't just shout back at them? He didn't just respond to them in the way that they had spoken to him? And I think sometimes the first thing that many people do when criticized is just to snap back and criticize the ones who have criticized us. You think we're feeble? Is that what Nehemiah said? And isn't that the way we respond a lot of times when opposition rises up against us? They'll say something, and man, we got to shoot something back to them. Nehemiah, he didn't do that. Nehemiah didn't say, you think I'm feeble? Man, look at you, Sanballat. You are nothing more than a petty governor in a province, in a small empire. I'm the cupbearer to the king. And you're going to criticize me? He didn't say, Tobiah, look at you. Tobiah, you are nothing more than a governor of a little hot place of real estate out in the middle of the desert called Amnon. You are a nobody from nowhere. No, he didn't respond like that. He did not answer his critics with criticism. Because had he have done that, he would have simply been bringing himself down to their level. And he would have reduced himself spiritually. Friends, here's what I'm saying. Never answer criticism with criticism. Never answer scorn with scorn. Never answer anger with anger. Never answer being gossiped about with gossip. Never respond in that kind of a way. Because every time we respond in that kind of a way, we lose our testimony. You know what opposition is? Opposition is an opportunity to let the glory of God shine through our lives as we are seen by responding in a different way than the opposition responds. It is a great opportunity for you and I to display a healthy witness for the Lord Jesus Christ. So what did he do? Well, he didn't retaliate. What did he do? He did three quick things, so simple and yet so profound. First of all, he prayed. He prayed. Down in verse 4, hear, O our God, for we are despised. Turn their reproach on their own heads and give them as plunder to a land of captivity. Verse number 9, nevertheless, we made our prayer to God. Because of them, we set a watch against them day and night. So the first thing that he did was he prayed. Let me tell you something about the opponents of God, the opponents of Christ, the opponents of Christ's church, the opponents of God's people, the opponents of the Bible. Let me tell you something about them. They can criticize us, they can slander us, they can accuse us, they can gossip about us, they can mock us and ridicule us, but they cannot close up the windows of heaven for our prayer-answering God. They cannot do that. And I think Nehemiah understood that. And that's why the first thing that he did, he came to the Lord in prayer. I am absolutely touched by this prayer. friend, when you read this prayer down in verse number 4, what he's doing, he's calling out for the justice of God upon the opponents of the people of God. Hear, O our God, for we are despised. Turn their reproach on their heads. Give them as a plunder to the land of captivity. Now, there is nothing wrong with that kind of a prayer. That is not in conflict with the instructions of Jesus, who said that we're to love our enemies and we're to pray for those who persecute us. Friend, there is nothing loving about wanting someone who is an opponent of the people of God to continue in their evil ways. There's nothing loving about that. The most loving thing we could possibly do for someone that is an opponent to the work of God is to pray for them that God might reveal his justice against their sin, that they might repent and believe. That's a good prayer. That's not a bad prayer. And so he offers up this prayer and says, God, I pray that they would get a revelation that your justice is against people like them who are opposing your work. My heart is touched by the first thing that Nehemiah did. First thing he did, he didn't talk to his critics. He talked to God about his critics. You know, sometimes here is what we tend to do, and I'm putting me in this group. Sometimes what we tend to do is when opposition rises up and shouts at us, we just want to see if we can shout a little louder back at the opposition. You know why that last argument in your home lasted as long as it did? Because somebody kept yelling. That's the only reason it lasted as long as it did. Let me tell you something about an argument. An argument must run in twos. It's impossible for there to be an argument where one checks out and refuses to argue. So if there is an argument in my home, which there never could be because I am a pastor, but if there is an argument in my home, the best way for it to stop is for me just to shut my mouth. And I think that Nehemiah understood that, hey, me arguing with the opposition, that's not going to accomplish anything. And you see, when he went to God in prayer, it did two things. Number one is it diffused his anger, because we see no response of anger at all. Now, friends, please hear this. This is so vital in dealing with opposition. We've got to diffuse any anger that we have toward them, because responding to opposition with anger from a child of God is never productive. In fact, it usually hinders the work of God. Usually just stops the work of God right there. I will never forget something my mentor, Brother Wallace Russell, always taught me. He said, now, Craig, when you get out there and you're pastoring a church and you face opposition, if you want to lose the integrity of your witness, your character, and your leadership, you just let the opposition see you get in the flesh. And that will kill it. So you see, I think that as he prayed, what God did was God just diffused his anger. And he did not respond to the opposition in an angry way. And then the second thing that he did was he refocused his perspective. Because the Bible says immediately what to do, he got back on the wall and started building again. That was what God had called him to do. God didn't call him to win an argument. God called him to build the wall. And friend, that's what God has done with us. He has not called us to win arguments with the world when the world opposes us. He's called us just to build the wall, preach the gospel, do the work of God. That's what he's called us to do, not get out here and fight with the opposition. So he prayed. But then he persisted. Verse number 6 tells us about his persistence. So we built the wall. The entire wall was joined together up to half of its height. For the people had a mind to work. Not to argue. The people had a mind to work. It is almost like Nehemiah ignored the opposition, and he kept on building the wall. Friend, I want to tell you, his YAC stats were high. Are yours? Are mine? When we can get to the place where we are more concerned with the approval of God than we are the opposition of man, we'll do some good things then. And that was Nehemiah's passion. But there was a third thing that he did, and that is he protected. He protected. Down in verse 9, nevertheless, we made our prayer to God, and because of them, we set a watch against them day and night. Now, later on in the chapter, it tells us what happened was that Nehemiah put swords in the hands of all of the builders. So the deal was, yes, he prayed because he understood that his strength was found in God, but at the same time, he gave them a sword. Why? So they could protect what they already had built. Friends, don't miss that lesson. If you are committed to rebuilding an area of your life, you better protect what you rebuild, because there will always be opposition that is trying to tear that down. I know, because since I have been in this series, there have been some areas of my life the Spirit of God has put his finger on and said, Craig, you need to rebuild that. And I have tried to do that. And opposition has arisen to try to tear down what I have rebuilt. It will always be there. Don't let it do it. I think that one of the greatest problems in America today is that generations have arisen that have refused to protect what our founding fathers sacrificed to build. And the same thing could be said about the church. You know, the church that we find in the book of Acts, instituted under the leadership of Almighty God, they raised up a church. They built a church, and it was built on worship and prayer and evangelism and discipleship and fellowship. That was what God inspired the church to build the church with. That was the materials. And friend, what the church built and dedicated to the glory of God is worthy of our defending. And you see, the only reason the walls get broken down is because we just won't defend them. You better learn how to block out opposition. You don't do it with anger. You don't do it with vengeance. You do it on your knees, right? That's how Nehemiah did it. And the more time that we spend on our knees advancing in the kingdom's work, the less time that we will spend retreating from the attack of opposition. One of my favorite football players of all time was Reggie White. Anybody remember Reggie White? He died at the age of 43 with a massive heart attack. He played most of his career with the Philadelphia Eagles and some with the Green Bay Packers. Great defensive end. He was also a committed Christian and a preacher of the gospel. He pastored a little church while he was also playing professional football. Because of his commitment to Christ and his great ability to play defensive end, he was called the Minister of Defense. And he had a way of just living in the opponent's backfield, sacking the quarterback. I know that he was had the most amount of sacks of any defensive player in history for a long time, and he may still hold that record. But there was one particular game, and he was just living in the opponent's backfield. Poor quarterback was going down, it seems like, every other play. And on this one particular play, Reggie White put a move on his blocker, got around him, and smacked and laid out the blocker and the quarterback at the same time. When Reggie White was coming back to where that player was lying on the ground, as a Christian, he reached out his hand and helped him up. And then Reggie White said to him, he said, Jesus loves you, and so do I. But you really need to learn how to block. if we're going to defeat opposition, we really need to learn how to block. Friends, stand up. Stay up. Keep your place on the wall. Don't allow ridicule and opposition and intimidation to stop you from being God's man, God's woman, God's student in this generation. Because if not you, who? Paul says to all of us, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Friend, be known for your yards after contact, and you'll glorify God because of it. Would you stand, please? Heads bowed and eyes closed. No one looking around. I'm not sure what God's spoken to your heart about today. If it is that you need a Savior and you've been dealing with that for some time now, someone has shared the gospel with you, witnessed to you, but you've not yet opened up your heart by faith and trusted Jesus Christ, the invitation is for you to come to Him, receive Him as your Savior. The invitation is for you to come today if God's led you to be a part of our church family. We'll receive you. The invitation is for you to come and pray if God's touched your heart about something. Maybe the invitation is to get back in the game. You've allowed opposition to just put you on the sideline. You've quit. You've run in the opposite direction. And today you want to get back on the wall and start building. Father in heaven, I pray in Jesus' name that we would take the message about opposition to heart, and we would not let it even slow us down, much less stop us from living for your glory. In Jesus' name I pray.
Thank you so much for tuning in to our broadcast. I hope that you have been strengthened and encouraged in the faith through the music and the teaching of God's Word. Our goal here at First Baptist Church is to help people love God, obey God, and serve God. And this is also the goal of our television ministry. And so I pray that this has happened in your life today. I would love to see you personally and meet you if you ever have an opportunity to visit with us. And remember, you're always welcome at First Baptist Church in downtown Panama City.